case, I will ask Ms. Hornsby to call her next witness.
Well, good morning, Ms. Shembury. I'm afraid we just need to remember to do the switching, otherwise we may not be heard at the back. Can I just first of all introduce you for meeting inquiry, please? You are Angela Shembury, is that correct?
It is.
It is?
Yes, I am.
And you are planning director at RPS. You hold a Master of Town and Country Planning, and you are a member of the Royal Town Planning Institute, and you have over 16 years' experience in private sector town planning consultancy, is that correct?
It is.
You've been instructed on a number of airport aviation related projects, including in relation to Stansted Airport, where you provided strategic planning advice as part of the consultant team, and you helped to prepare the planning applications for both the proposals to make better use of the existing runway and the development of the second runway. And you are currently instructed by Gatwick Airport Limited as part of the RPS consultant team to progress their aspirations for a second runway. Is that correct?
It is.
And you tell the inquiry that you were first instructed by Riverwave in relation to Manston Airport in December 2015, is that right?
Correct.
And your role since that time has been to provide strategic planning advice in connection with their proposals to reopen the airport principally as a hub for international air freight, is that right?
This is.
Now, Ms. Shembury, you produce three documents in inquiry. First of all, your summary proof. Secondly, your main proof of evidence, and thirdly, your rebuttal proof. That's tab 13. Tab 13 for the summary. Tab 6 for the main proof. And the appendices between the two. And then I think the rebuttal should be freestanding. So if I can ask you, please, Ms. Shembury, to take out your summary proof of evidence. And if we turn to the introduction, I think we've already covered those points, but can I just ask you, please, to read from paragraphs 1.4 and 1.5.
My evidence deals with town and country planning matters, including planning policy. The evidence which I have prepared and provided for this appeal is true, and I can confirm that the opinions expressed are my true and professional opinions. My evidence demonstrates that the appeal proposals are not in accordance with the relevant policies in the development plan, that these policies attract full weight, and that there are no material considerations which indicate or justify departure from these policies.
Thank you, Ms. Shembury. You then set out in your summary, and I'm not going to ask you to read these out, but Thanet District Council's position in respect to these appeals. I think that's all clear. And then you go on to deal with that in a little bit more detail in section two of your evidence and in your summary. Again, I'm not going to ask you to read that out. If we can then turn to your section three, please. You deal there with the National Planning Policy Framework. No doubt that is very familiar to the inspector. I'm not going to ask you to read any of that out. You then deal with the Aviation Policy Framework, dated March 2013. I'm not going to ask you to read that out. You then come on to deal with the Draft Airports National Policy Statement. And then finally, you come on to deal with Kent County Council's local transport plan. I'm not going to ask you to read any of those paragraphs out, but what I am going to ask you to do is just to read your summary, the summary of that, if I can describe it in that way, and ask you to read paragraph 3.14 through to 3.16.
It is evident that a key objective of national planning policy is to ensure that planning has a role in proactively driving and supporting sustainable economic development to deliver infrastructure that the country needs and to respond positively to wider opportunities for growth. The government fully recognises the major contribution that the airport sector makes to the economy. The government supports the growth of this sector in order to achieve long-term economic growth. The national policy framework for aviation is underpinned by an encouragement to grow airports, fully recognising that international connectivity is important to the success of the UK economy. The policies contained in the National Policy Framework for Aviation are material considerations in planning decisions, and accordingly significant weight should be attached to them. And finally, reopening Manston Airport is crucial to delivering Kent County Council's regional growth policies. The airport has the potential to develop and become one of the largest single generators of economic activity in the county. The River Oak evidence submitted to the inquiry demonstrates that there is a need to reopen Manston Airport. It will deliver much needed infrastructure, which in turn will deliver economic growth on a local, regional and national level in order to wider growth opportunities fully consistent with national planning policy objectives. Development map plan policies and decisions on planning applications should continue to protect the Manston Airport site for airport uses, as this is entirely consistent with the national policy context. Using the buildings for non-airport related uses would not be acceptable having regard to national policy.
Thank you. You then come on in section four to deal with the development plan. I'm not going to ask you to read out paragraphs 4.1 to 4.3 where you just set out the relevant policies. You then come on to deal a little bit more detail at your paragraph 4.4, where you set out the various policies. I am going to ask you to read out, though, please, if you wouldn't mind, paragraph 4.4, insofar as it sets out policy EC4. Can I just ask you to read that paragraph, please? That part of the paragraph.
So, reading out what policy EC4 states. Policy EC4 is a site development area and states that land at the airport is identified on the proposals map is reserved for airside development. Development proposals will require specific justification to demonstrate that an airside location is essential to the development proposed. Development will be required to retain sufficient land to permit access by aircraft of up to 65 metres, 217 foot, wingspan to all parts of the site.
And you then come on to deal with the issue as to whether the policies that you've identified, and that's EC1, EC2 and EC4 are up to date. I think it's EC4 that is particularly critical to this appeal, these appeals. Can I ask you please just to read out the first paragraph, first sentence of paragraph 4.5?
Policies EC2 and EC4 in promoting and protecting land for airport uses are wholly consistent with the MPPF, the APF, the Draft Airports MPS, and the Kent Local Transport Plan, therefore considered to be up to date.
And the next sentence, please.
Accordingly, full weight should be attached to these significant policies. The fact that the airport is no longer operational does not reduce the weight that should be attached to these policies, especially in light of the evidence the River Oak has submitted to the inquiry. The ABS Solutions Report is not robust and cannot be relied upon.
Thank you. Now, I'd just like your help with this, please. Why do you say that policy EC4 is consistent with the National Planning Policy Framework, the aviation policy framework, the draft national policy statement, and the Kent Local Transport Plan? Just taking those points in order, please. Firstly, the NPPF. Why do you say EC4 is consistent with that national framework?
So the NPPF states very clearly that the government is committed to securing economic growth. In order to create jobs, prosperity, and the planning system should do everything to sustain that economic growth. In needing to do this, the local plan policy, and particularly EC4, needs to protect land for aviation use, especially given that there is a reasonable prospect of the airport reopening.
Thank you. Coming on to the aviation policy framework, why do you say EC4 is consistent with that?
So the aviation policy framework relates to safeguarding and states that the National Planning Policy Framework, the NPPF, makes it clear that local planning authorities should identify and protect where there is robust evidence, sites that could be critical in developing infrastructure to widen choice, and this could include airport infrastructure. I think it's obvious from the evidence that was presented by Dr. Dixon and Mr. Kane yesterday that there is robust evidence which demonstrates that Manston Airport could reopen as a viable airport, and so therefore it is critical that the local planning authority protect the land at the airport for these uses, and that is consistent with what the APF states.
Are you relying on specific parts of the NPPF which specifically says that infrastructure?
So the reference is paragraph 33 in the NPPF, and in the APF, so the Airport Policy Framework, is paragraph 5.8.
And in the light of the fact that the appellants don't seek to challenge the evidence of Mr. Kane and Dr. Dixon, what do you say about that in terms of assessing the consistency or otherwise of EC4 with national policy?
If not contesting the evidence, that suggests to me that they feel that there is a, or there may be a reasonable prospect of the airport reopening. In that sense, full weight needs to be applied to policy EC4 in light of the advice in the NPPF and the APF.
Thank you. And then the draft national policy statement, is EC4 consistent with that emerging policy?
It is. The draft NPS on airports maintains the government's support for the aviation sector in its capacity to assist with objectives that seek to secure economic growth. And in that sense, it is still fully consistent with what is said in the NPF and the NPF. More specifically, the draft airports NPS talks about air freight, which is particularly relevant given the proposals by Liberoak, and is extremely supportive of air freight growth, again, to help the aviation sector and to deliver economic objectives. And in that statement, it states that it is expected that air freight will grow. So all the signs suggesting that the aviation sector is healthy and therefore policies need to reflect that and be consistent with them.
EC4, in seeking to protect the airport for airport uses, in the light of the fact that there's a reasonable prospect that it can be put to use as an air freight hub, how does that then square with the emerging national policy statement?
It's entirely consistent with it, and therefore needs to attract full weight.
Thank you. The next point I'd like your help with is this, please. If we can just go back to policy EC4, which you set out at page 10 of your summary evidence. If we just look at that in a little bit more detail, please. We can see that it says there that land at the airport, as identified on the proposals map, is reserved for airside development. Can I ask you, please, just to take out the FANIC local plan, which is CD 12.1. And can I ask you to turn in that document to page 34, which is concerned with the airside development area. And if we look at the first sentence of policy EC4, we can see that the policy essentially reserves the area identified for airside development. And if we look at 2.74 in the second sentence, we can see there airside development is defined. And it says there it's defined as usage with an operational requirement for direct access to aircraft and therefore dependent on a location immediately adjacent to the runway or capable of direct access to it via taxis ways. Mm-hmm. Now, these proposals, are they concerned with buildings that are located within the airside development area?
They are.
And are they for airside development?
No, they're not.
And therefore, are these proposals in accordance with or contrary to policy EC4?
They are not in accordance with policy EC4.
And as far as you can ascertain Mr. Alston's evidence, does he dispute that? Is there any dispute between you and the appellant that these proposals are contrary to the main policy that relates to them?
No, there isn't.
And if the proposals are not in accordance with policy EC4, what in your view is the effect of section 38 subsection 6, which directs how the determination of these appeals should be made?
So policies that are contrary with contrary to EC4, which is a policy in the development plan, in light of there being, in my opinion, no material considerations which would justify determining those proposals in accordance with those policies, then the appeals should be refused because of the contrary, contrary to policy EC4.
And the issue that Mr. Alston raises is, well, he's saying that that policy attracts, I think he says it attracts some weight, but he says it attracts less than full weight. And in considering the application or what weight to apply to EC4, both you and Mr. Alston have considered whether there's a reasonable prospect that the airport will be used as an airport. Is that, in your view, the correct approach for this inspector to determine whether or not full weight should or shouldn't be given to EC4?
I think that's entirely the correct approach that needs to be taken. The policy seeks to safeguard land for airside uses if it can be demonstrated that there is a reasonable prospect that the land can be used for those particular uses, then it should be protected. Full weight applied to EC4, and the appeal proposals are contrary to that.
And is the reasonable prospect approach supported by national policy?
It is. There is advice in the MPPF which specifically relates to proposals that seek to promote non-aviation uses, not specifically non-aviation uses, uses that are employment uses.
Shall we just take paragraph 22 out?
32, yes.
Oh,
that's
nice.
One thing that would be most helpful for me, sorry to interrupt, is that I've got the copy of the local plan. I'm not sure, perhaps you may be able to direct me to it, whether I've got a copy of the proposals map. This might be something the council can assist with.
So you don't? You don't, because it's not available, as I understand it, in hard copy form. But in anticipation that you might want a copy, because I've certainly asked for a copy so I can see where the airside development area actually is.
That's right.
We do have a hard copy which we've managed to sort of photoshop and download from the internet, simply just showing the key for airside development area and also where that relates to on the...
Yes, that would be extremely helpful, because I was scouring all these documents and I couldn't actually see them.
No, you're right, it isn't. No. I have had that printed out, so if you just...
I've sort of taken everyone's word for it, but it is...
Yes. Perhaps in the...
I mean, we don't have to have it now, but that could be arranged.
I've actually got a rather useful clip, which...
Yeah, that's fine. I don't wish to interrupt.
No. If I may say so, sir, it's an absolutely crucial point, and you must be furnished with that information.
Thank you.
I have one copy here, which...
Ah, thank you very much. That's very helpful. I'll number this because it's been put in. So this will be, we're now up to. I think it's a document date. Sorry, yes. So 8 is Caxton, 9 is Dover, 10, so this is 10 indeed.
I'm out of approach.
Okay. This is the original.
No, we haven't been asked one until now, so.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Yeah, so this is document 10.
Thank you.
I wonder if it might be helpful for you, Mr. Nunn, if I just read out what's in the local plan about what it defines as being the airside area, so it's quite helpful to you. Obviously, you have a plan, but it basically says that it's land north of the runway and includes the land north of the B2050.
Where are you reading from?
So this is paragraph 2.74 in the 2006 adopted. Yeah. So the very first sentence, lands north of the runway, including lands north of the B2050.
2.74. I see. Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
And Mrs. Shelby, we're just coming on to look at paragraph 22 of the NPPF. So do you have that now in front of you? And the point that we were on is whether the reasonable prospect approach is the correct approach. It's the approach that you and Mr. Olson have taken in looking to the weight that should be attached to EC4. And can you just explain to the inspector why, in your view, you and Mr. Olson are right about that?
So paragraph 22 of the NPPF specifically states that where there is no reasonable prospect of a site being used for the allocated employment use, in this case, airport use, applications for alternative uses of land or buildings, i.e. non-aviation use, should be treated on their merits, having regard to market signals and the relative need for development for different land uses to support sustainable local communities. So the no reasonable prospect test is entrenched in that advice in the NPPF and is what we should be considering these appeals against.
And how should the issue of whether there is a reasonable prospect that Manston Airport will be used as an airport to be approached by this inspector, in your view?
So in my view, the fact that there is a reasonable prospect that the airport could reopen means that full weight should be accorded to policy EC4. That is to safeguard a form of development that is in the national economic interest, consistent with the National Planning Policy Advice. And therefore, I do believe that any planning decisions should be made in accordance with these policies, unless there are material considerations that would justify not determining those proposals in accordance with those policies. Again, I'll say that I don't think there are any material considerations, and on that basis, the appeal should be dismissed.
Thank you. Can we now go, please, to your rebuttal proof of evidence? And I think in your rebuttal, you deal in a little bit more detail with the specific points that have been raised by Mr. Alston. So if I can just ask you, please, to turn to section 2, This is a section that goes directly to the weight to be attached to policy EC4. And can I ask you please to read from paragraph 2.1?
Mr. Alston asserts that saved policy EC4 of the adopted Planet Local Plan 2006 should carry limited weight in decision making for the reasons he sets out in paragraphs 6.6 to 6.11 of his proof. I disagree for the reasons set out in paragraph 6.6 to 6.10 of my proof of evidence. However, I would like to address some of the specific points that Mr. Alston relies upon. So point number one, policy EC4 and the local plan as a whole was intended to cover the period to 2011 and is therefore time expired and out of date. So in response to that, I have said that whilst the adopted local plan period extended to 2011, I do not agree that policy EC4 attracts little weight merely because the plan is time expired. Policy EC4 remains a saved policy and part of the development plan. It attracts full weight because it is consistent with the National Policy Planning Policy Framework, the Aviation Policy Framework, the Draft Airports NPS, and the Kent Local Transport Plan. The fact that the airport is no longer operational does not reduce the weight to be attached to the policy, so long as there remains a realistic prospect that it can become operational once again. Clearly that is the case as demonstrated by the evidence produced by McGrow.
Just focusing on that for the moment, is there anything in policy EC4 which says that the airport has to be operational for it to apply?
No.
2.3, please.
Even if contrary to the view I have expressed above, the presumption in paragraph 14 of the MPPF is engaged because policy EC4 is contained in a time-expired plan and is out of date for that reason. In my view, the policy still attracts substantial weight in the paragraph 14 balancing exercise. The appeal proposal's conflict with this policy comprises the significant adverse impact which strongly weighs against the proposals and significantly and demonstrably outweighs the benefits such as they are. These relate to employment generation, but as there is land available elsewhere in the locality, both inside and outside the district, which is specifically protected by policy for employment uses, this benefit, in my view, only attracts very limited weight. Any potential occupiers whose locate to these areas and the significant policy conflicts could be easily avoided.
Have your help on this. Simply because the Thanet local plan is time expired, does that in your view mean that saved policy EC4 is out of date?
It doesn't mean the policy is out of date. The MPPF is specific in terms of how you interpret whether a policy is out of date. There is a measure requiring for there to be some consistency with the National Planning Policy Framework, and we've already discussed why I believe that policy EC4 is consistent with the NPPF. So therefore, the fact that it is contained in an out-of-date plan does not mean that any less weight should be attracted to it.
And is the fact that the airport is currently closed or not operational, again, a reason why less weight should be applied to EC4?
No, I don't think that's a valid reason. There is every prospect, as we've demonstrated, that the airport could become operational again. So therefore, there should be no less weight attached to it, policy EC4, just simply because the airport is closed.
Thank you. And then if we can go on in your summary, you deal with your subparagraph B, or heading B, with the issue taken by Mr. Alston that the local plan proposed a formal review of the potential implications of airport growth on development in the district in 2005-06, but that review did not take place, and therefore that reduces the effectiveness of policy EC4. And can I ask you to deal with that point by reading 2.4, please?
So I disagree agree with this assertion.
Sorry, are we looking at the summary?
So I disagree with this assertion. Firstly, the paragraphs referring to review are explanatory text to policy EC2, not policy EC4. Secondly, the purpose of the review was to see if any changes were necessary to policy EC2, again, not to policy EC4. Thirdly, the plan was adopted in 2006, so it was not possible to carry out a review in accordance with the suggested timeframe in any event. Fourthly, the review is now being undertaken as part of the emerging local plan, which is how the explanatory text anticipates any changes to policy related to Manston Airport to be brought about. In the meantime, there is no reason why, because a review has not been undertaken, the policy EC4 should not attract full weight. The policy seeks to preserve the integrity of the airport's airside development area for unrelated uses, buildings and structures until such a time as any changes to the policy have been justified. Currently, the new local plan is emerging and policy EC4 needs to be considered as part of that process. Until such time as any changes are made to policy EC4, there is no reason why policy EC4 should not attract full weight.
Thank you. And then you then come on to deal with the point raised that policy EC4 is based on an evidence base that has proven by actual events to be incorrect. And over the course of a significant period of time, the policy has been proven to be non-deliverable and therefore ineffective. So can I ask you to read 2.5, please?
Policy EC4 has been an effective policy, as it is preserved to protect land at the airport for airside uses and has preserved the integrity of the airport. Policy EC4 has therefore to date, and despite closure of the airport, delivered on its objectives. It needs to continue to do so whilst the future of the airport is resolved through the GCO process and the emerging local plan process, given that the evidence before this inquiry demonstrates that there is a realistic prospect of airport being used as an airport. Policy EC4 has remained effective and delivered on its objective to protect land at the airport from non-aviation related uses. No non-aviation uses have been permitted at the airport during this time, either on a temporary or a permanent basis. And I carry on later to talk about operations stack, which I think we'll come to. Policy EC4 therefore remains necessary to protect and safeguard the airside development area.
Thank you. You then come on to deal with the point raised that there have been a material change in site-specific circumstances since policy EC4 was adopted, which indicates that the policy objectives are unlikely to be deliverable. And these are various points raised by Mr. Alston, the first being that the airport has closed. And can I ask you to read 2.6?
So the fact that the airport closed was a decision made by the airport owners, who were not airport operators, and who had no intention of using the land for an airport, but rather who had acquired the site speculatively for £1 in circumstances that are somewhat opaque, and in order to promote a new residential-led development upon it.
Just pausing there, Ms. Shembri. Yesterday, that was disputed by Mr. King. Can I just have your help with this? Is there any evidence that has been put into this inquiry to demonstrate that any expert advice or assessment or any financial assessment was undertaken by the owners of the airport when they first acquired it to ascertain or to see whether or not a viable airport could be operated from it, in particular as a freight hub?
Not that I'm aware of.
Therefore, is there any evidence before this inspector to support the assertion that the land wasn't acquired speculatively for residential development?
Sorry, can you just say that again?
Yes. Is there any evidence before this inquiry to demonstrate that the land wasn't acquired speculatively for £1 for residential development?
No, there wasn't.
Can we come back, please? 2.6, second sentence, since its purchase.
Since its purchase, those airport assets that could be sold off have been. In my view, the closure of the airport by the present owners does not justify an assertion that no weight should be applied to policy EC4 because its policy objectives are undeliverable. Clearly, the objectives of ensuring the future integrity of the airport are deliverable, as River Oaks evidence demonstrates. However, the current owners have made it clear that they will not contemplate using the land as an airport. The planning system operates in order to protect the public interest, not the private interests or aspirations. This is why generally the use of land is controlled and protected by policy. In my view, the fact that the airport is currently owned by those hostile to its reuse as an airport reinforces the need to give full weight to policy EC4 at the current time, whilst its future is resolved through the DCO and the local plan process.
Thank you. You then come on to deal with the point that the CAA licence has been revoked. Can I ask you to read 2.7, please?
So the licence has been revoked, given the actions of the current owners in selling off those assets necessary to justify a licence and the owner's decision to close the airport. However, I do not see why this should affect the way to be applied to policy EC4, which seeks to ensure and protect the integrity of the airport. An application for a new CAA licence can be made concurrently with any proposals to reopen the airport, and indeed River Oak will be applying for a new CAA licence alongside submission and determination of their DCO application, and I have already been in discussions with both the CAA and Queen's in relation to this. I do not see why the revocation of the licence renders the policy ineffective.
Thank you. You then come on to deal with the point raised that multiple owners have tried and failed to operate a viable airport at Manston. You heard the evidence yesterday that was given by Mr. Kane and also by Mr. Yerrill as to why previous owners of the airport have failed to essentially make a success of it. None of that evidence has been challenged by the appellants. Those witnesses also say that there is no reason why those past failures need to be perpetuated into the future if an appropriate level of investment and the correct focus is given to the airport. In the light of that unchallenged evidence, can any weight, in your view, be given to the fact that past owners have failed to make a success of Manston Airport?
No, I don't think there can be any weight attached. There are very specific circumstances, as we heard from previous witnesses yesterday, as to why the success of the airport did not take place. That does not mean that going forward, and certainly with River Oak, who have a strong commitment to bringing forward the airport, there's no reason why that wouldn't happen in a viable sense for the airport to succeed.
Thank you. Well, I'm not going to ask you to read 2.8 out then. Can we move on to the next point, please? That's that it's now an effectively vacant site. And can I ask you to read 2.9, please?
So the fact that it's a vacant site is a different way of making similar points, all of which amount to the same thing, namely that the airport is not currently operational. The lawful use of the land is as an airport, and policy seeks to protect that. And until such time as the policy changes, it should attract full weight.
Thank you. You then come on to deal with the point raised that there's a significant bank of evidence that indicates that the prospect of an airport reopening on a viable long-term basis is unlikely. You then go on to refer to Mr. Yerrill's evidence, and then also over the page to Dr. Dixon's evidence and Mr. Kane's evidence. But on the basis that now none of that evidence has been challenged, is it fair to say that there is a significant bank of evidence that indicates that the prospect of an airport reopening is unlikely before this inquiry?
No, unfortunately, there's significant evidence that suggests that there's a reasonable prospect of the airport opening.
Insofar as the AVIA Solutions report seeks to suggest that an airport isn't viable, on the basis that Mr. Kane has explained that that document is not a sound document, and on the basis that Dr. Dixon has said that, in her view, no weight should be applied to that document, and on the basis that none of those judgments have been challenged, what weight at this inquiry can this inspector attach to the AVIA Solutions report?
think very little weight can be attached to the OVSolutions report for the reasons we had yesterday, and the simple fact that it hasn't actually yet been tested. So I would attach very little weight to that document.
Thank you. Can we go over the page in your rebuttal then, please, paragraph 2.11? And there you deal with the point raised that the DCO has made little progress. And can I ask you to read from that part of paragraph 2.11 that commences, "I disagree"?
So I do disagree that there has been little progress made with the DCO, and there have been numerous meetings between River Oak and PINS in discussing the proposed DCO. Six public events have been organised and informal consultation has already been undertaken with the local community. The scoping reports have been produced. Discussions have taken place with the CAA, Kent County Council, the Environment Agency, Natural England, Historic England, Southern Water, Parish Councils and the trustees of the Spitfire Museum at Manston Airport. A draft statement of community consultation was submitted to Thanet District Council and Kent County Council in February 2017. River Oak also consulted with Dover District Council, Canterbury City Council and 11 nearby parish and town councils on the proposed public consultation, pre-submission of their DCO. I consider that River Oak are on track to submit a DCO in summer 2017. So Mr. Yarrell's proof of evidence demonstrates the strong commitment that River Oak has towards pursuing their DCO application to reopen Manston, and the considerable effort and resources that they have expended to date towards securing their ambitions. I consider that contrary to Mr. Olsen's suggestions, considerable progress has been made by River Oak in pursuing the DCO, insofar as they have been able to do so. However, they have been significantly hampered in progressing the DCO by the actions of the appellant, who have consistently refused them access to the airport, which is necessary to carry out survey work required for the environmental impact assessment, and without which a DCO application cannot be made. River Oak first sought the agreement of the appellant to access the site on the 10th of February 2016. After one meeting and several exchanges of correspondence with the appellant on the subject, River Oak was left with no option but to make an application under Section 53 of the Planning Act 2008 to PINS for authorisation to access the land. This was made on the 1st of July 2016. After several further exchanges of correspondence between River Oak, the appellant and PINS, including River Oak agreeing to all of the appellant's conditions for access, but the appellant still refusing to grant access, PINS granted compulsory access powers on the 16th of December 2016. The site was finally entered upon on the 7th of February 2017, almost exactly a year since the first request was made. The appellant has been the principal contributor to delays in terms of River Oak progressing their project. So in order to grant such an authorisation, PINS needed to be satisfied that the proposed applicant in considering a distinct project of real substance genuinely required entry onto the land. So clearly, PINS are satisfied that River Oak's project is of real substance, and in my view is rightly so. Given that the delay to progressing the DCO has largely been due to the appellant's own actions, that is not a matter in my view that should weigh in the favour of Mr. Olsen seems to suggest.
Now, Ms. Shembri, in the light of all the information that is now currently in front of the inquiry, and in the light of points that you have just made, what is your conclusion about what that evidence indicates in terms of whether there's a reasonable prospect of Manston reopening as an airport?
So, in light of all the evidence and my views on the Aviation Solutions report, I do believe there is a real prospect of the airport reopening, and there's nothing that I haven't seen that suggests otherwise.
And in the light of that, what is the effect of that on policy EC4 in terms of its weight?
So full weight needs to be afforded to policy EC4, given that there is a reasonable prospect of the airport reopening. full weight being attracted to that policy and the fact that the appeal proposals are contrary to that policy suggests the planning permission should not be permitted unless there are material considerations, of which I don't believe there are any.
Now, can I just have your help with this? Can I just ask you to take out the appellant's opening submissions, please? And if I can ask you to turn to paragraph two of those opening submissions. It's stated there that in the second sentence, the only real question is whether the future reuse or redevelopment of the site as a whole would be materially prejudiced if the appeals were allowed. And if we go on into the document of paragraph 15, a similar point is made there. In approaching the determination of this, or these appeals, is that, in your view, the correct approach?
No, I don't believe that it is. The starting point to considering the appeal proposals is the level that it accords with the development plan policies. So that should be the starting point. Thereafter, there needs to be consideration of material considerations, but it's certainly not about whether there would be any prejudice if the appeals were allowed.
If the starting point is policy EC4, and if that attracts full weight, are there any other material considerations that counterbalance that full weight in your view?
No, there certainly aren't any that outweigh the accordance with that policy, or the fact that the appeals are contrary to that policy. No.
Well, I think you then come on to deal with potential material considerations. So can we then move on to deal with those? Can we move on, please, in your rebuttal evidence? And the first point that's made by the appellants is emerging policy SP05 as something that might counterbalance full weight that you say should be attached to policy EC4. Can I ask you to read 3.1, please?
So Mr. Alston, in paragraph 6.2 of his proof, states that revised policy SP05 is based on a robust evidence base and therefore should be afforded some weight. I disagree with this statement for the reasons set out in my proof of evidence, namely paragraphs 2.12 and appendix 1, which is a letter to Madeline Homer, the chief executive of Manchester Council, dated the 28th of October 2016. Where I state that no weight should be attached to revised policy SP05, that's in relation to paragraphs 611 and 617 of my proof. Further reasons as to why there should be no reliance placed on the evidence base, namely the ABS Solutions report of September 2016, are set out in Dr. Dixon's proof of evidence, that's paragraphs 2.1 to 2.14, and it's the Payne's proof of evidence, which is paragraphs 2.1 to 2.23. These are completed, but clearly in light of the significant opposition to revised policy SP05 and its early stage of production, no or little weight can be attached to it. Manchester Council still have a long way to go in the preparation of their new local plan, but at least their housing strategy is far from being formed in relation to the actual housing requirement and where or how it is to be met. It is my understanding that a lot of further work needs to be undertaken on the evidence base to justify the housing strategy in the emerging local plan, not least the whole range of sites that may be available to meet its housing requirements.
Now, you're saying that
you're saying that no or very little weight can attach to policy SP05. Can SP05, in your view, counterbalance EC4 as a material consideration?
No.